Okay, let's be frank about this. When people lose a job, the assumption is they're going to get another job. That may very well be true. But it also may very well be true that if you're a small business owner who piled all your savings into starting a restaurant and that restaurant just went away forever, okay, that is a life that has been wrecked. If you are a person who had some savings and now you've lost your job and the stock market has been hit and you're forced to liquidate your stock in order to pay your bills and the government response ain't coming for months, that is a life that has been wrecked. And to pretend that quality of life doesn't matter, that the only thing that matters are these sorts of projections, is wrong. Again, for the fourth time, I'm not calling for people to stop social distancing. I'm the one who's been pushing hardest for social distancing. I've been calling for social distancing since early March, just like everybody else when it became apparent that this crisis was actually a crisis. But I have not yet heard from experts sufficient to tell me what the metrics of success look like. If you were running a business, you wouldn't accept this sort of compromise. If you were running a business, you wouldn't accept people coming in and saying, we can forestall you hundreds of millions of dollars worth of savings. And you say, how? And they say, we don't know. Right? We know that we'll save you some money in the short term, but we have no idea what that looks like 6 months from now. Also, we need you to shut down your business for the next 3 months. It is going to be very difficult for anyone to explain, based on this modeling that has been provided so far, what anything looks like. And you're hearing this from the people who are in the epidemiology fields, right? They're all speculating. You hear from some people this will be over by June 1st. You hear from some people this will be over by May 1st. And maybe this is me railing against the sky because nobody actually has the data. Maybe this is we just have to take our best guess and wing it. And again, I'm willing to do that for a set period of time. I'm not willing to do that indefinitely. And I don't think anyone is willing to do that indefinitely. I do not think that anyone is willing to lock themselves in their house until June 1st based on models that do not even tell us what happens after August 1st. Again, the IMHE model can be completely right, and it still tells us nothing about what happened September 1, which I find that hard to believe, but it is true. Right? Where are the second wave models? Maybe, again, we don't have information about what happens after that. What happens when there is no herd immunity and there is no vaccine? There's just not enough information out there, which is why every day that people are looking for a vaccine becomes more and more vital, because bottom line is, without any sort of mitigating effects, without any sort of drugs that can mitigate the effects of this, without a buildup in ICU capacity or ventilator capacity, what exactly are we gaining here? Right? This is the point that I've been making all along. All we are doing is buying time for you not to get the virus. We are not buying time for you to never get the virus. We are buying time for you to not get the virus. So the question is, what happens on the other side when you do get the virus? Because the chances are very strong that in the fall, everybody is going to get the virus, because we're going to be out and about and doing the things that we like to do. And even with the masks, the chances are pretty strong that I just can't imagine the American people walking around in October, 7 months from now, wearing masks in public. I just don't think that the United States is not built for that. It's not the same thing as other cultures. That may be for good and it may be for bad. And I'm not the only person asking this question. The Washington Post has a piece today that says experts and Trump's advisors doubt White House's 240,000 coronavirus deaths estimate, according to William Wan, Josh Dowsey, Ashley Parker, and Joel Achenbach, leading disease forecasters whose research the White House used to conclude 100,000 to 240,000 people will die nationwide from the coronavirus, were mystified when they saw the administration's projection this week. The experts said they don't challenge the numbers' validity, but they have no idea how the White House arrived at them. I'm confused. How do you not challenge the validity, but you have no idea how they arrived at them? That's basically them saying we don't know what the hell anybody's talking about. White House officials have refused to explain how they generated the figure. They have not provided the underlying data so others can assess its reliability, or provided long-term strategies to lower the death count. Some of President Trump's advisors have expressed doubts about the estimate, according to three White House officials who spoke on the condition of anonymity. There have been fierce debates inside the White House about its accuracy. At a task force meeting this week, Anthony Fauci told others there are too many variables at play in the pandemic to make the models reliable. He said, I've looked at all the models. I've spent a lot of time on the models. They don't tell you anything. You can't really rely upon models. Then what the hell are we talking about? I mean, seriously, you may as well just say, we have no idea how many people are going to die. We think it's a lot. Shut down the entire economy. And the reason they're not doing this, is because they want you to rely on the quote unquote experts. Now, I'm fine with relying on people who know more about epidemiology than I do. I'm not challenging the inputs on the models. I'm not even challenging the models themselves. I'm saying the people who make the models are challenging the models. I'm saying the people who are creating the models understand that there's play in the joints. If you can't really rely upon the models, then again, just a question. How are you creating a metric of success? What's the metric of success? And the metric of success cannot be, you know, Governor Andrew Cuomo going out there and saying things like, the metric of success is, have we saved one life? Okay, that's just ridiculous. That's not a public policy proposal. Lots of things would save one life. You know, banning cars would save one life. No one's talking about doing that. Keeping everybody home will certainly save some lives. The question is, for how long? Who the people are who are going to get it? Does it buy us time to increase capacity? Is that time going to be useful? Right? None of these questions have really been asked.
I hope you enjoyed that clip from The Ben Shapiro Show. If you did, go ahead and hit the subscribe button so you stay up to date on all of our future content.